بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. In last week's class of the Seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through the tafseer of the Qur'an, we looked at the fifth set of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the fifth set of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a surah, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described it, أَعْظَمُ surah fi كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, the greatest chapter in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the name, or the names of this surah, the names of this particular chapter in itself, it shows us the excellence of the surah or the chapter. And the name of the chapter which you look at was Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha, the surah of the opening. And we said it's called Surah Al-Fatiha, firstly because the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the order of the Quran, it begins with what? Surah Al-Fatiha. We also said it's called Surah Al-Fatiha because As-Salah will begin with what? Surah Al-Fatiha. And from the names that this book, this surah is known by, is also what? What's the other name of this surah or this chapter? What other name is it known by? Sorry? Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book. And we said it's called the mother of the book لأنها تشتمل على مقاصد الأساسية لكتاب العزيز. Because in Fatiha is contained the primary goals and principle behind the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all the topics of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is contained in where? Surah Al-Fatiha. That's why it's called Ummul Kitab. Because anything which covers anything comprehensively, the Arabs will call it what? Mother. So for example, Earth, Ard. One of the names for Ard is also what? Mother. The flag under which the soldiers gather under is called what? And from the names of this book, likewise, or this surah, this chapter is also what? What's the other name for Surah Al-Fatiha? We mentioned all in all, it has over 20 names, but we only want three that is famously known by, that's been mentioned in a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have Fatiha, we have Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book. And what's the last one? Only three I want, so this is the last one. Naam. La. That's mentioned in the hadith. You. Ibn Sheikh Sa'id, the son of Sheikh Sa'id Archer. Yes. Tayyib. Ya Abdullah. Where's Abdullah? Aywa. Ya Abdullah. La. Ya Luqman. Ibn Ana, my son now. So I'll be fair. Ya Luqman. Ya Abd al-Rahman, subhanallah, ajeeb, barakallah fi. Because we said there's ikhtilaf, there's difference of opinion amongst the scholars, whether this surah, this chapter is Makkiyah or Madaniyah, whether this surah was revealed in Mecca or Medina. But we said this surah was revealed where? In Mecca. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Hijr, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبَعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي. We've given you the seven often repeated verses. And this surah, Al-Hijr, is surah to what? Is surah what? Makkiyah, Meccan surah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we're giving you the seven often repeated verses. And seven often repeated verses is mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Fatiha was revealed. He said, this is the great Qur'an I've been given. Sab'a min al-mathani, wal-Qur'an al-azim. So one of the names of Surah Al-Fatiha is the seven often repeated verses. And we said that this week we're going to move on to the next phase of the seerah, which is what? Sab'a al-mathani. Yes, sab' al-mathani. We said we're going to move on to the next phase of the seerah as we divide it up, which is what? Open propagation. But before we do that, we're going to explain Surah Al-Fatiha due to the importance of Fatiha. But before I go into Fatiha, ya Luqman, where's the pen? We asked some questions last week, or a question last week, a very important question, and we promised a gift. And I could not find a better gift that would be in line with everything we've been teaching so far from the seerah than this particular gift. Because from the very beginning of the seerah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his ni'mah. Alladhi 'allama, the one we taught, bil qalam, he taught with a pen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wal qalami wa ma yasturun. So I could not think of a better gift than the gift of a pen. So our brother will answer the question last week. So before I forget, inshallah ta'ala, there's one down, three to go. Nice pen as well, mashallah. Qulu mashallah. Allahumma barik. So this is for our brother here, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. So, due to the importance of surah, we're going to pause on it and understand Al-Fatiha. Because Al-Fatiha, we open with it, As-Salah. And many a times, we find that the Salah which we pray sometimes doesn't have an effect on our behavior, our character. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. That Salah, it leads you away from illicit behavior and munkar and evil. But that's the Salah that has an effect upon your heart. And for that Salah to have an effect upon your heart, you have to understand what you're saying during Salah. And if this is the seven most often repeated verses, go recite it how many times a day? At least 17 times. We should understand it. We should understand Surah Al-Fatiha so that it may have an effect upon us. So that we may have khushur, concentration in our Salah. In fact, from the names of the Surah itself is what? As-Salah. And why is this surah itself called Salah? Because the hadith of Qudsi, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qasamtu Salah bayni wa bayna abdi nisfayn." I divide the Salah between me and myself in two halves. And in that is mentioned Fatiha, to show the importance of understanding Al-Fatiha. So I want to go to the meaning of what we're saying when we stand before Allah Azza wa Jal, we say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So the Salah may have an effect upon us. As Allah Ta'ala says, "Qad aflaha al." Mu'minun, indeed successful are the believers. Alladhina hum fi salatihim khashi'un, those who have khushur, humility in their salah. So we begin after Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And I'll say after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim because some of the ulama have the opinion that al-Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is part of what? Surah al-Fatiha. Like the Malikiyya, they say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is part of Fatiha. But the most authentic opinion, Wallahu A'alam, accepted opinion is Al-Basmala is not part of Fatiha, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. But it is a part of the what? The Qur'an. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to the chapter of the Qur'an, the way you know the separation between them is what? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So it is part of the Qur'an, but Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is not part of any surah except for one surah. And what surah is this? No, what surah is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim a part of? Huh? Naml, barakallahu fi. The ayah, innahu min Sulaiman, innahu Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's the only surah in the Quran that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, bi ijma' with consensus, is a part of. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, began with Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with Athina, Alhamdulillah. And in the translation of Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, what's the translation, ya Luqman, of Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen? Sorry? La, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Barakallahu fi. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the tafseer of Alhamdulillah, all praise due to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that would benefit from Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that the meaning therefore is Wasful Mahmood Bil Kamal Mahabbatan wa Ta'zeeman Lah. That when you say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, it's a description of the one that is being praised. You're describing him with perfection out of love and out of exhortation. So when you say Alhamdulillah, this is what? A description of the one that is being described with what? Perfection out of what? Mahabbatan, love and exhortation. But where is the proof? Because Luqman said Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen means all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All praise in all its types, in all its form. Where is the proof of this? This goes back again to understanding the language. Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, Alhamdu fi kalam al-Arab al-thina'a kamil. That when you say Alhamdu, according to the speech of the Arabs, is complete and perfect praise. Why? Because of two letters. And what are those two letters? Alif wal lam. So we don't say Alhamdulillah as it rolls off on many people's tongue. How are you, brother? Alhamdulillah. La. Alhamdulillah. Or in Fatiha, you don't say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. It's what? Alhamdulillah. It's al alif wal lam li istighraq al jins. That the alif and lam, when you say al, it covers every single type of praise. Every single type of praise in every single form. Alhamdu. So when you say Alhamdu, it means all praises in all its forms, in all its types, is for who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is why Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullahu ta'ala went on to say that fi Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Dalilun ala kama sifatillah. This is a proof of the perfect attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ala kamal ni'mihi ala ibadihi, and a proof of his complete favors upon his slaves and his servant. So when you say Alhamdulillah, it's a proof of what? The complete favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with something, bestows upon us something, favors us with something, what do we say? Alhamdulillah. What if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not provided you with something, bestowed upon you something, what do you say instead? The dua of the awam, of many people, the general folks, they say, Alhamdulillah, الَّذِي يُحْمَدُ عَلَى الْمَكْرُوهِ. All praise is due to Allah that He is praised even upon that which is hated and disliked. But this is not from the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because when you say all praise is to Allah who is praised in that which is even hated and disliked, it's like you have a problem or an issue. But the dua from the sunnah is what? Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. All praise is due to Allah under all circumstances, under all conditions. Why? Because the praise for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? Perfect. There's no decrease. There's no deficiency. And in order for us to understand this, I'm going to pause upon something. That we say we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying Alhamdulillah. We show gratefulness. What is the difference between shukru walhamdu? Thanks, gratefulness, and hamd. What is the difference between these two things? To show subhanallah how great hamd is. Now, Barakallahu fi. Ash-shukru, we have to first and foremost define what is shukr. Ash-shukr, they say yakun fi muqabil an-ni'mah. Shukr is something which you say or do in return for something that was done for you specifically. So you give me this, for example, I say thank you, brother. Wa yakun qawlan wa 'amalan wa i'tiqadan. And thankfulness and gratefulness is shown in three ways. With your tongue, with your actions, and in your heart, meaning you're grateful in your heart. This is shukr, that is in return for a specific favor somebody done for you, and it's expressed with the tongue, with the hand, and in the heart. And that's why the sha'ir, the Arab poet, says, أَفَادَتْكُمُ النَّعْمَاءَ مِنِّي ثَلَاثَةٌ. The favors which you've done for me has benefited you in three ways. How has it benefited you? It's لِسَانِي وَيَدِي وَلِسَانِي وَالضَّمِيرُ الْمُحَجَّبُ. it's only benefited you in three ways. It's benefited you in the form of my hand, meaning I show gratefulness to you with my actions. Walisani, with my tongue, because I show gratefulness to you with my what? With my tongue. Wadamir muhajjab, and with my heart, because I'm grateful to you in my heart. So shukr is done in return for a what? A favor. And it's shown in how many ways? Three ways. But hamdu, as the brother says, is different. Hamdu is more general. It covers both shukr and praise. So you say, for example, hamidtu rajul ala shuja'atihi. I praise such and such a person because of his braveness. Oh, ala ilmihi, or because of his what? Of his knowledge. So this person, maybe due to his braveness, he has helped you in a particular situation. So you praising him, what are you doing? You're thanking him. What if this person has never directly assisted you with his braveness, but he's a brave person? Can you still praise him? You still praise him. You say, Hamitu Rajul, I praise such and such a person for his braveness. Whether he's assisted you directly or indirectly, the sifa, the attribute on the description of braveness, is he still in him? He's still in him. A person of knowledge, maybe he has taught you. So you thank him, Hamituhu, I praise him for his knowledge. What if he's never taught you? Is the attribute of knowledge still within him? It's still within him. And that's why likewise, when it comes to Alhamdu, we say this is a proof of the perfect ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Wahhab, the one that bestows. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon you a child, you say Alhamdulillah. In thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What if you've never had a child and Allah ta'ala has tested you, as many have been tested with no children? What do you say then? Alhamdulillah. Why? Because whether you have a child, you don't have a child, you've been bestowed or not bestowed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. So Allah ta'ala belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth. He creates whatever he wills. يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا. He's the one that bestows on whatever he wills, male or female, وَذُكُورًا, and male. So whether he's giving you a child, he hasn't given you a child, Allah ta'ala says what? Al-Wahhab. So Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because his sifat, his attributes are perfect and they're always there. So there's never a time or in any situation a Muslim could say, I can't say Alhamdulillah. I remember once bumping to a brother who was in a very difficult situation due to what his own hands had earned. And I saw him, I said, Akhi, how are you doing? He said, you know what, Akhi, things are so bad, I could not even say Alhamdulillah. A'udhu billah. You never, ever, ever, that should never come out of your mouth. Alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. And the more grateful you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what your situation will be, Allah ta'ala said, wa la in shakartum la azidannakum. If you're grateful, I will increase you. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to show the beauty of Alhamdulillah. And that's why this surah is also called what? Ad-du'a. It's called what? From the name of Fatiha, Ad-du'a. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, afdalu du'a. The best du'a is Alhamdulillah. Subhanallah. The best du'a is Alhamdulillah. Wa la in shakartum la azidannakum. If you're grateful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you. So Alhamdulillah, due to its meaning, is a proof of the complete attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after this, we say Lillahi. This praise is due to who? Allah. Lillahi is a proof of what? A tawheed. The oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In what category of tawheed? Uluhiyya. In his worship. The only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves to be worshipped. And here is an important question. What does it mean when we say La ilaha illallah? Ya Mas'ud, La ilaha illallah. Barakallahu fi. Only Allah has the right to be worshipped. Many a times people say La ilaha illallah means there's no God but Allah. La. There's many deities and gods that are worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the meaning of La ilaha illallah, La ma'bud bi haqqin. Nothing deserves to be worshipped in truth except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you say Lillahi is a proof of what? The uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you say Rabb alameen. And this is the affirmation of what? Allah's rububiyyah, that there's no Lord but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And saying there's no Lord but Allah has consequences. That means we believe. When we say there's no Lord but Allah, it means we believe there's not what but Allah. We mentioned three things. As a Lord, three attributes of a Lord. There's no what? Khaliq, creator but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no what else? There's no Razzaq. No one gives sustenance but Allah ta'ala. There's no Mudabbir. No one controls the affairs but who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what else? No one gives life or death but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala said, this is a proof that there is a Rabb. And this is a revision for us now. A Rabb, the word Rabb is taken from what? It's taken from what? In Arabic. We said it's taken from the word At-Tarbiyah, which is to nurture, to cultivate. Meaning, if in the creation are those that are being cultivated, are being nurtured, there must be a what? The nurturer. Meaning, if from the meaning of Ar-Rabb, man yaqoom bishu'oon islah ghayrihi, the person who takes control or charge or care of others' affairs. Our affairs are taken care of. There must be one who's taking care of those affairs. From the meaning of Rabb kadhalika, is if the meaning of Rabb is the one that cultivates you, nurtures you, and also does what? Take care of your affairs. What does it mean you have to do for that person? What is upon you for that person? For example, I ask my children this. Somebody nurtures you, takes care of you by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, provides housing, clothing, yes, and cares for you, jayyid, and take care of your affairs. What do you have to do? Obey that person. So from the meaning of Rabb in the Arabic language is Sayyidun Muta', a master that is obeyed. Jayyid, a master who is obeyed. And that's why I go to Surah to Yusuf, when he saw the dream, he said, Yasqi, I see in a dream, what is he giving to his master? Yasqi Rabbahu Khamra, he's giving his Lord wine. And his Lord here means what? His master. So Rabb is a master. And this, the reason this is very, very important to understand that Rabb means the one that cultivates, nurtures, the one that takes care of affairs and is a master is, this shows a clear distinction between the cultivator, the Lord, and his objects or his subjects. And why is this difference important? Because يكون فيه رد على قول أهل الإلحاد القائلين بوحدة الوجود is a refutation against or belief in the omnipresent nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a creator and there is the created, because Allah's Lord is the creator. There's the one that nurtures and the one that is being nurtured. There is the one who is the master and there's the one that is the what? Servant. But when you say Allah is omnipresent, a dangerous belief that Allah is everywhere, there's no clear distinction anymore. There's no clear distinction. But we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere with what? Knowledge. He sees and hears everything and is aware of everything. And that's why some of the people that believe in this particular belief, they say on the omnipresent nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the extreme of them, they say sadaqa fir'aun. That Fir'aun, he spoke the truth when he said, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, I'm your Lord the Most High. Because Allah is in him, is in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah is everywhere. A'udhu billah. So, this is a proof of what? A refutation. Also, when you say Rabb, it's a proof of what? That if you're being careful, nurtureful, sustained, taken care of, is a proof of what? The whole world and everything within it is in need of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever young men in the age we're living in, the time of education, which sometimes education, secular education, if you're not careful, is a form of indoctrination, that you should have a furqan, a criteria which you walk with that accompanies you everywhere. And your criteria as a Muslim doctor, Muslim engineer, architect, whatever you may be, your criteria you walk upon is what? The Quran. That's your furqan. One of the names of the Quran. That when you're in your universities or your schools, and an agnostic, he comes to you, an atheist comes to you, or someone that denies the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, where is the proof that there is a God? Where is your proof now? Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Because if you are created, there must be a what? A creator. And Rabb is the one that what? Creates. And that's why when the mushrikeen of Quraysh, when they heard the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ, he said his heart almost flew out of his chest. That are they created from nothing or they're created? If you are provided for and sustenance is given to you, there must be a what? A provider. إِنَّ اللَّهُ رَزَّاقُ. This is a refutation against those denying the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them. أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تَحْرُثُونَ. Do you not see that which you sow in the earth? أَأَنْتُمْ تَزْرَعُونَهُ أَمْ نَحْنُ زَارِعُونَ. Are you the one that causes it to grow or we cause it to grow? لَوْ نَشَاءُ لَجَعَلْنَاهُ حُطَامًا فَظَلْتُمْ تَفَكَّهُونَ. If we willed or wanted to do so, we'll make it dried and wither. You walk around in amazement. أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ. Do you not see this water which you drink? أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ مُنْزِلُونَ. Did you cause it to come down from the clouds or we cause it to come down? لَوْ نَشَاءُ لَجَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا فَلَوْ لَا تَشْكُرُونَ. If we willed, we'll have made it bitter. So why are you not grateful? So in Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen is a refutation against the atheist and the agnostic. And also in Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is a proof that the Malaika wal Rusul wal Awliya, that the angels, the allies of Allah, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have no control of anything. Nothing. Nothing at all. No affairs, because only Allah ta'ala is in control of the affairs. Yesterday I saw a YouTube video of some women in one part of the world beating up somebody referred to as a peer. A peer is like what they call a holy man. And they found that he was a fake holy man. And when they called the police, he jumped out of the window and he broke his leg. And the women were beating him up. Now in the first place, if people understood Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, they'll know no prophet, no angel, no so-called holy man has control of affairs. Therefore who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he doesn't know the unseen. If he had known, لَاسْتَكْتَبْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ, I will increase only in goodness. وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءُ, no evil will touch me. So in Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is a proof that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge of all things. Now, Alhamdulillah Rabb, all praise is due to Allah ta'ala, the Lord. Al-Alameen, Alameen, what's the meaning of Alameen? Al-Alameen, literally, Al-Alam or Alameen is the plural of world. Or the plural of what? World. World in Arabic is Alam. But the literal meaning, Afwan, I'm sorry, the literal meaning of Alam is sign, symbol, or indication. Sign, symbol, or indication. So the flag in Arabic, what's the name of flag in Arabic? Alam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the worlds a what? A sign. And a signal. And a symbol. So Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala said, Al-alameen dala ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That all this alameen, ayah, they are proof and evidences to show the what? The existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُقِنِينَ. And in the earth is a sign for those who have certainty. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And even in your own self, do you not see? So the world which you see is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the world is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you see this creation, and you, subhanAllah, you ponder upon this creation, there's a sign of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the meaning of alameen, non-literal, it means the worlds. Allah ta'ala didn't say the world, but the world. So the ulama of tafseer, they say the four worlds. The world of the angels, the world of the jinn, the world of mankind, and the animal world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, is the one that nurture, cultivates, the one that deserves to be obeyed in all these different worlds. And then Allah Ta'ala says after that, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why does Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala mention Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim? After mentioning, he's the one that controls all affairs. And this is a lesson for us as parents, as educators, as teachers. After mentioning, he's the Lord, meaning he's the one that controls, he's the one that creates, sustains all this world. Allah Ta'ala says Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. دليلاً as a proof على أن ربوبيته, that the lordship of Allah, His creation, His nurturing, His control is built upon mercy. Subhanallah. Everything is built on mercy. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سَبَقَتْ رَحْمَتِ غَدَبِي. My mercy always precedes my anger. That as for us as parents, we want the best for our children. But our nurturing and cultivating of our children should be built on what? Ar-Rahmah. Upon mercy. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الرَّحْمَةِ or إِنَّ الْلِينَ, that gentleness, مَا وُضِعَ فِي شَيْءٍ, is not put into anything illa zana, except it beautifies it. And hardship is not put in anything except it makes it ugly and disfigured. And we all make these mistakes as parents because we want the best for our children. And some of the things we do for our children that may be harsh because of love for our children. I remember as a young child sometimes growing up in Africa, your uncle, when he comes and beats you, and it's not a beating like, I mean in the West they'll probably call that child abuse. The beating was serious beatings. Not like what you young men today call beating. And they will say to you, you know what son, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you. That's how intense the beating was. I remember when I was in Egypt, there was a teacher. He said, he hit a child. He said, لَوْكَانَ حِمَارًا لَمَاتَ. If that particular child was a donkey, the way I beat him, the donkey would have died. The hitting. So our nurturing, our cultivation should be built on what? Ar-Rahman. With our students, our children, our wives. Luqman is whining. Yes, should be built on Rahman. Should be built upon what? Upon mercy. Jayyid? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. What's the meaning of Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim? These are two attributes that denote mercy. And we're going to stop on this. Very important. Rahman and Rahim both mean mercy. Right? Mercy, mercy. The most merciful, the most merciful. What's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Rahim? Sorry? Barakallahu fi. They both denote mercy, but there's a slight difference. Now. The Prophet said, this from the meaning that Ar-Rahman is intense mercy, Ar-Rahim is continuous mercy. Jayid? Na'am, Ya Qaisar. Na'am, he said from the meaning likewise, Ar-Rahman is for everyone in the creation. Allah Ta'ala has mercy on everyone, Muslim, non-Muslim, pious, impious. And the Rahim, they say, is only for the believers. And that's how from the dua is Rahman al-Dunya. Yeah? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rahman al-Dunya wal-Akhirah. That is the merciful Ar-Rahman Dunya of this world. Yes? Wa rahimahuma, afwan. Is a Rahman of the Dunya, but is a Rahim of both. Meaning only to the believers. Only believers in this world and in the hereafter, it shows Ar-Rahim. But to summarize it, and we end on this. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. First and foremost, Ar-Rahman min al-asma is from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Rahim is also from the names of Allah azza wa jalla. But the difference is Ar-Rahman min al-asma al-mukhtassa billah. Ar-Rahman is from the names that's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's not permissible to name anybody other than Allah Ar-Rahman. That's the first difference. It's the names that's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, some of the scholars have the opinion that that hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qad da'awta Allah bi ismihi al-a'zam alladhi idha du'iya bihi ajab wa idha su'ila bihi a'ta." When he said to the companion, "You've called upon Allah by His greatest name." That name which Allah Ta'ala, if he's called by, he answers the dua. If anybody seeks anything, Allah gives them. They say it's Ar-Rahman. They say it's Ar-Rahman because of the hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he said that the name of Allah Ta'ala, A'zam, is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alif Lam Mim. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Some say it's hayyu al-qayyum. And also there's another ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. I can't remember the ayah exactly. But they derive from that the greatest name of Allah is what? Ar-Rahman. So there's certain names which is only for who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None other then Allah Ta'ala could be named by that name. So Rahman, that's the first difference. Min al-asma al-mukhtassa. Secondly, the second difference is Ar-Rahman is vast mercy. Vast, vast, envelopes everything. Why? Because anything in the Arabic language that comes ala wazni fu'lan, that has that pattern of sound, phonetically, fu'lan, it means something which is vast. So in Arabic, if you're hungry, say ana ja'i'. But if you're extremely hungry, say ana jaw'an. Do you understand? So anything that has that sound, fu'lan. So in Arabic, if you're angry, you say ana ghadib, I'm angry. But if you're very angry, say ana ghadban. You understand? The sound now, fu'lan. So it's rahman. In Arabic, if you're thirsty, say ana atish. But if you're very thirsty, it's what? Atshan. So rahman means ar-rahma al-wasi'a, vast mercy. So therefore, rahim, if rahman is from the names, that's only for Allah. Rahim is for what? From the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And other than Allah could be called what? Rahim. And that's why in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ar-rahimun. The people who are rahimun, yarhamuhum ar-rahman. Ar-Rahman has mercy upon them. So can you call a human being Rahim? Naam. Bil-mu'mineen, when Allah Ta'ala described the Prophet ﷺ, bil-mu'mineen, ra'ufun Rahim. When it comes to the believer, is ra'uf Rahim. But can you say Ar-Rahim? Many people, they believe the difference is the alif or lam. The difference is not in the alif or lam. The difference always go back to the principle, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if you put alif and lam before it. Because in Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَالَتْ إِمْرَأَ الْعَزِيزِ, the wife of the minister. And what does Allah ta'ala call the minister? Aziz or Al-Aziz? Al-Aziz. Jayyid? Al-Aziz. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Hayy. Al-Hayy. But Allah ta'ala, when it comes to the human body, say, يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ. It takes al-hay, the living out of the dead. So the difference is not the alif or lam. So al-Rahim is from those names that other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could be named by. Secondly, al-Rahman is vast. Al-Rahim, al-Rahma, al-Wasila. Allah ta'ala, it chooses specifically whatever it wants to touch with this mercy. Understood? So al-Rahman, al-Rahim. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala. I'm going to stop on this, inshallah ta'ala. This was the explanation, and the Maliki Yawmiddin. We covered last week up to Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, up to Ghayr al-Maghdubi alayhim wa al-Dhalin. So we stopped at Maliki Yawmiddin. In other classes, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, because we're trying to finish in due time for Ramadan, we're going to tafsir of Fatiha. But this is just a short tafsir of Fatiha. So we could continue upon our program, which is the next phase of open da'wah. And this open da'wah, how many weeks are we going to spend upon it? 6 weeks. After open da'wah, we're going to talk about what? Hijrah, the migration to the Medina, and the verses surrounding it. After that, we're going to end with what? Life in Medina up to the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So next week, we're going to go back to, not tafsir, but the seerah, by doing the tafsir and the circumstances surrounding a revelation that happened during the open stage of da'wah. And this will be the sixth set of verses to come down upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And based on what we've spoken about so far, I think it was 2 weeks ago, about open da'wah, we mentioned, was it Surah Al-Qalam we did last? We did Surah Al-Qalam, right? No, Surah Al-Fatiha we did last. And we said, hidayah, guidance is in the hands of who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there's people that are close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're never guided. So we said there were some people close to him, they were never guided. And the next ayah, or the next thing going to be from Seerah, is related to this ayah. So who could think what surah that would be? Of those who were close to the Prophet ﷺ, never guided. In fact, they were enemies to the Prophet ﷺ. No, a surah from the Seerah, this is the sixth to be revealed, that when the open da'wah began, the people closest to him, one of them was the first to reject him and become the biggest of enemies to him. Barakallahu fiqh, Surah Al-Masad. So next we're going to go to Surah Al-Masad, how the open da'wah began. That when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood on Safa, and he called them on Safa, wallahi, amazing, the beginning of this da'wah, and the suffering that they suffered in the beginning of this da'wah, the attack. So next week, inshallah ta'ala, for 6 weeks, we're going to go into open da'wah. And then after that, inshallah ta'ala, what happened as a result of open da'wah, they had to leave, they had to migrate. And then life in Medina, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, by Ramadan, in those 18 weeks, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we should finish. Any questions, inshallah? No.